This is the second installment in a four-chapter blitz that gets us to the quantum Fourier transform, or QFT. Much of it is skippable, and you've got your individual prescriptions in the tables at the bottom of these web pages. The path to the quantum Fourier transform takes us now through the ordinary or continuous Fourier transform, which is a little surprising. Fourier series, where we started, are sums, and the QFT, where we're headed, is also a sum. But today's continuous Fourier transforms are integrals. So why do we have to get messy with integrals if we're going to ultimately return to sums? The only way to really get that answer is by forging ahead in your reading. But you can get the answer and still skip much of this chapter by following one of my suggested subpaths. Now that we've shown how a periodic function can be constructed from sums of sines and cosines, we naturally want to do it for any function of the reals, even ones that have no periodicity evidence at all. The Fourier transform gets us there. We begin with the final expressions we had for the complex Fourier series and make a few adjustments to those formulas to cover non-periodic functions. I'm not going to develop those adjustments rigorously, but in any textbook devoted entirely to the Fourier transform, they would do it in two stages. First, let those periodic functions stretch so that their fundamental intervals get larger and larger in an attempt to cover the entire real domain, at which point they stop looking periodic. Then, divide the real axis into smaller and smaller delta x intervals. The net result is that the sum becomes an integral as delta x approaches zero, and the limits of integration become minus infinity to plus infinity as we stretch the fundamental interval to cover the entire real line. What we end up with is a pair of formulas. The first one tells us how the original function can be constructed as a kind of weighted sum of exponential functions e to the isx, which are called the Fourier basis functions. The second formula tells us how to generate the weights for that sum. Let's take a closer look at the first formula. We consider the letter x to be the domain variable and the letter s to be a parameter, constant for each exponential term. Those exponential component functions are the embodiment of pure frequencies comparable to e to the inx of the Fourier series. Now, however, the integer frequency n is replaced by a real frequency s, and the spectral sequence C sub n appears here as a function of the reals capital F of S. The value of big F evaluated at the real number S is the amount of the Sth frequency function e to the isx needed in the recipe for our original small f. And how do we determine each frequency's weight? With our second formula, similar to that used to compute the Fourier series coefficients. But now the symmetry is stunning. Compare the expansion of the original little f along the Fourier basis functions with the computation of each coefficient big F of s. We can see that they're practically identical. The function whose values are weights, big F of s, is called the Fourier transform of little f of x. What I'd like you to do is think about this integral first. It's our desired expansion of an arbitrary function, little f of x, along the frequency basis. The coefficients, big F of s, are unknown. From there, I give the formulas to compute the coefficients, big F of s, and that formula is called the Fourier transform. This is subtly but critically different than starting with a definition of the Fourier transform formula without any context. There is no understanding if you use that as your entree into Fourier transforms. It merely feels like a magical, unintuitive integral that randomly turns up again and again in math and physics. Our way of doing it forces us to understand that the Fourier transform is an answer to the question, how do we expand f along the individual frequencies e to the isx? Well, that's the most important conceptual idea. and everything else in this chapter emanates from it. We'll go on to learn how to compute Fourier transforms, see some transform pairs, meet the delta function, and cite a few big consequences like translation invariance and the convolution theorem. This last litany is only for the more information-hungry among you who want a mini-course in Fourier transforms. If you just read the few sections I consider essential in your tables, you'll be fine later in the week when we get to the QFT.